Hey, this is Jesse Tula for batchframe.com and welcome to another video quick tip. In this one, we're going to talk about how to create your own presets. Now, if you've seen my tutorial on creating custom pseudo effects, then you know how to create the controls, but how do you take those controls and actually make it into a preset that will do something in After Effects? Now, for this example, we're going to be using this 3D looking text. It's not actual 3D text, it's just got a bevel and a ramp on it to make this design. So, it's pretty simple. But we're just going to make it so that you can easily add this to a new text layer and control the different attributes based on the different size of the text or whatever. You might want to change some of these things, and so we're going to make this preset that allows us to do it quickly and without having to go through the list of effects. Now this is actually fairly simple. There's only three effects. We have our ramp, which you can see as I turn it off what that does. We have the bevel, and then just a faint drop shadow. And depending on the background, this would be more or less apparent. What we're going to do is create a preset that controls these three effects and allows us to quickly edit the attributes that are important to creating this effect so that when we apply it to different size layers and different text, everything is very easy and simple to edit. So the first thing I'm going to do is create the pseudo effect. Now I've already started here in the batchframe custom controls creator, and you can see how to get there, batchframe.com/custom controls. And I've already got most of my controls set up. I'm just going to create the last two that I need. So we'll create a slider for the ramp size. And this is going to help us control the length of the ramp, so the start and end points of the ramp, depending on how tall our text is. And then one last slider. And this is what we'll use to set the shadow softness. And since we can't have it be any harder than zero, we'll set that as the min value. So now we have all our controls. I'm going to choose get the code. We have this pop-up with our XML code. I'll copy that. I'll go into my XML file right after the last effect and paste it. And I'll hit save. And then I'll copy this JavaScript. Now in order for that to be active, I'm going to have to restart After Effects. So I'll just close out of this and start back up. Okay, so now that we're in After Effects, I'm going to go to File, Open, and I'll open that same project. All right, so now that we have our project open, I'm going to create a new layer. And I'll just type tutorial. And we'll move some things around real quick. Get this guy out of the way. Alright, so the first thing I want to do is let's add our custom control we just created to this layer. So we'll open the script editor, file, scripts, open script editor. We'll paste in the JavaScript that we copied from the site, and we'll hit run. And just make sure that you have your layer selected that you want to apply it to. Now if we go into the effect controls, you can see 3D text, our control, is there. But right now, none of these controls actually do anything. And that's what we're going to be working on the rest of this tutorial. So let's add our first effect, which is the bevel. So I'm going to go to Effect, Perspective, Bevel Alpha. And what we want our bevel thickness to control is this edge thickness property. So to do that, we're going to Alt-click on the stopwatch for edge thickness and simply pick-whip the bevel thickness control. And you can see that once we click off of it, the bevel goes away because now the edge thickness is set to zero, being controlled by the bevel thickness. So if we increase this back to 2, you can see that the edge thickness goes back to 2. If we increase this to 5, you can see the edge thickness goes to 5. And that's kind of the thickness of the bevel that I'd like to use for this. So we're actually done now with the bevel alpha. And let's go on to the next effect, which will be our ramp effect. So effect, generate ramp. And we actually want to put this effect above the bevel alpha so that we have both the ramp and the beveling taking place. Now, the problem with the ramp effect on text is that when we move our text around, you can see it's not locked to our text. Our text is actually moving through the ramp. So we want to fix that by attaching, using expressions, the start of ramp and end of ramp positions to the position of our layer. So let's do that real quick. We'll Alt-click on this start of ramp. We'll bring up the position for our layer. And I'm just going to pick whip the position for the start of the ramp. So you can see that control now moved to the exact same place our anchor point is. Now our end of ramp is still in the wrong place, it's down here, and we want it to be offset to the top. So for that, I'm going to alt-click this, first choose our start of ramp, and we'll just set this equal to a variable just so it's easier to work with. So we'll set this to start, and we want to add a certain amount so that it moves above our start of ramp position. So I'm going to just type start plus 0 because we don't want it to move left or right, we just want it to move up and down. And then negative so it moves up, and I'll just say 120. So now you can see that our end position is at the top of the text. Now one of our controls is this ramp size, and that's what we're going to use to control how far our end of ramp is from the start of the ramp. So rather than 120 here, let's delete that, put it in some parentheses just to encapsulate what we're about to do, and we'll pick whip the ramp size control. And once we click off of that, you can see that it goes to this vertical line, and that's because our start and end positions are now exactly the same because our offset, our ramp size, is set to 0. But if we increase this even to just 1, you can see the change. And as we increase this back up, you can see our control is now controlling the size of the ramp. And as we move things around, you can see our ramp stays right with our layer. Now, one problem we do still have, and you can see if I bring up the rotation, is that you can see it's not completely locked. And this can be fixed by just pre-composing the ramp effect, but then we wouldn't be able to do it with our preset. But I'll show you how to correct it using expressions at the end of this tutorial. It's a pretty lengthy and it's a lot of math, so it's a little bit above basics, but if you want to see how to do that using expressions, just wait until the end of the tutorial. Alright, so now let's connect our color controls. So let's first just choose the start color. So we'll alt-click the start color of our ramp effect, and I'm going to pick whip our start color control. And when we click off of that, you can see now our start color is controlled by our control. Alright, now we want to set it for the end color. Now there's two different options for our end color. We have this color offset control, which is basically going to take the start color and just make it a little bit lighter. And then we also have our custom end color, which depending on whether this checkbox is checked or not, will be either be using the color offset or we'll use our own custom end color. So let's just hide this for now and we'll start with just our color offset. So let's alt-click on the end color for our ramp, and we're going to start out with just our start color. So if I clicked off right now, we now have the exact same color for both the start and the end. But what I want to do is add an offset. Now the way you add to a color is to use a color array, which is four different values for red, green, blue, and the alpha. Now we're not going to affect the alpha, but we are going to affect the three first color values. So to get our color offset, we're going to create a new variable, and I'll just call it offset, and we'll set that equal to our color offset. Then we're going to take our effect color, and I'll just make this a variable also just to make it a little bit easier, set that equal to color. So now what we're going to do is say color plus, and we're going to open our brackets, this is our color array, and we're going to write offset, comma, and I'm just going to copy this because we're going to use the same value three times, so copy that offset, offset, comma, offset, comma, offset. And the last one is our alpha, now we don't want to change that at all, not that it really matters, but we're going to just set that and leave it at 0. And if I click off, you can see there's no change. But if I change our color offset value, you can see it immediately goes to this white color. Now the reason it goes to white so fast is because colors, when we're adding them like this, it's only using a value between 0 and 1. And since we're above 1 right here, it's all the way set to 100%, it's completely white. Now if we set a value such as 0.5, you can see that we get an orange value. But we want to be able to use a wider range of the slider. So what we're going to do is we're just going to divide this offset value by 100. So now, as we scrub through the slider, you can see we get a gradual change in our color. Okay. So now let's worry about this group and this checkbox. What we want to do is be able to turn on or off whether we're using the offset or just this color. And to do that, we're going to use an if statement. So let's go back up to the very beginning of this, add a little bit of space, and I'm going to type if, that has to be lowercase for it to recognize it as an if statement. I'm going to say if our checkbox is checked, and that's by saying true, so saying is equal to, and this double equal sign is important. So we're saying if the checkbox is true, if it's checked, then we want to use the end color. Otherwise, or else, we're going to use what we just set up for the offset. Okay, so you can see that after doing that, nothing changed, and we can still use our color offset. But if I check this box, you can see our color changed to white. And now if we go into our end color, we can change this to whatever we want, and it's now just using our end color. So by just checking or unchecking this box, we're going between the color offset or the end color selection. Cool. So now the only control we have left is the shadow softness. And what we're going to do for that is add our drop shadow. So effect, perspective, drop shadow. And we'll just set some settings here just to what I like. Distance 0, opacity to 100. And we're just going to alt-click the softness and pick whip the shadow softness. So now as I increase this, our shadow is increasing. Now that might be a little bit hard to see, but I can just turn this off real quick, and you can see that shadow, and as we increase the softness, it's increasing for our layer. All right, so that's really it for this tutorial. That is how you can use your own controls to control the different parts of a layer. Now let's say you like this effect, you want to be able to use this quickly on any other of your layers. All you have to do is select all of your controls, just shift select all those, and you're just going to drag it into the effect and presets window. That will bring up a save dialog, and we can just type in, we'll override this test ramp. Yes, to replace it. And now let's say we created another text layer. Type in test, here's our test ramp preset. Just drop it right on, and you can see it automatically created that exact same effect right on our layer. And we can use those same controls that we set up with the expressions already set, and we can completely change it for our new layer. All right, but that is it for this quick tutorial. It ended up not being so quick, but you could see how to connect your pseudo effects to controls. And it doesn't have to necessarily be a pseudo effect. You can use the expression controls, but this is just a cleaner and nicer way to look at it if you're going to be using this a lot. So it might be a good idea to create custom controls if it's something that you're going to be either giving to other people to use, or if you want to use a lot, just to have all your controls in one place, it can be pretty helpful. Okay, so now for those of you that are interested, we're going to work on fixing the problem that happens when we rotate our text and the ramp is not locked on. So let's hide some of these other layers for now, because we don't need to worry about them. And what we're going to do is bring up our property, which is going to be this end of ramp property. So we'll hit U on the keyboard to bring up all of our properties that we need to worry about. And I'm just going to get rid of all the ones except for end of ramp. To do that, I'm just hitting Alt and Shift on the keyboard and then clicking on the properties that I want to get rid of. And then I just also want to bring up our rotation properties. So Shift R. And that will bring up our rotation. All right, so let's get rid of the expression we have here for now. And we're going to be creating new X and Y values. And in order to get these values, we're going to use some trigonometry. Now, what makes it difficult is that we need to get new position values with an x and a y coordinate based on a rotation. So we can't just parent things because we're in expressions and we're inside properties. We have to actually use math and trigonometry to find the new values. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a new value for x and a new value for y, and then add that to the start of the ramp. So the first thing we're going to do is create our x value, or our x variable. And we want to set our offset distance first. So I'm just going to pick whip the ramp size, which is our offset. And we're going to multiply this by the cosine of our rotation. So for cosine, you type in capital M math.cos and then parentheses. Inside these parentheses, we'll just pick whip our rotation. And we're going to then do the same thing for our y variable. So copy that, paste it, and change the x to y. And we need to change the cosine to sine. Then to actually apply this to our layer, because we need to have an array of two values, not just two single values, we're going to take our start of ramp position and add the x and the y. So let's just set this ramp size to 0. And you can see that our ramp right now is going directly up and down. Now to fix that, because we want the line to be going left to right, so our ramp is going up to down, we're going to subtract 90 degrees from our rotation. So minus 90. You want to make sure this is within the parentheses. And minus 90 here also. Now you can see there's no change, and that's because right now our ramp size is set to 0. But if we change this just to 1, you can see it's still off, but it's not directly up and down anymore. And the reason it's still off is because our formula here actually needs to use radians, and we're using degrees, which is what's here and here. So what we need to do is convert degrees to radians. And there's actually a very simple way to do that. You can just type degrees to radians, and the capitalization there is important. And we'll just enclose that, and you want to make sure that that's inside the cosine function. Now, there's an even easier way to add it, and instead of typing it, you can go over to this arrow, go to Other Math, and there's this degrees to radians function right here. Click on that, puts it in there for you. Just have to replace the placeholder with what we want. And enter. And now you can see it's gone, and that's because it's actually below the text right now. But as we increase the ramp size, you can now see it's back to how it was before. Except now if we change the rotation, you can see the ramp is staying right with our text. Alright, so that's some pretty complex math for you and using expressions, but that is it for this tutorial. It was supposed to be a quick tip and it ended up being way too long. Anyway, I'm Jesse Tuller for batchframe.com. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.